All right. Welcome everyone to our English worship service. For those of you that came a little bit earlier on time, you got a sneak peek as to some of the technical difficulties we're dealing with behind the scenes. Hopefully in the coming weeks, we'll be able to kind of work these little kinks out. We're so glad all of you are here online virtually with us this morning as we worship God together. As is kind of the custom in our church, before we start our worship service, we want to take a couple minutes or maybe just a minute to say hi to everyone. And so go ahead and scroll through the different faces that you see and just say hi. So this is to say hi to everyone, okay? So go ahead and do that now. Just say hi to everyone.
Hi. Good morning.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome.
So good to see all of you.
Hi.
Hi, Jake.
Hi.
Hi, Jake. You know which face it is?
Hello.
Hello, hello, hello.
Morning.
Gabriel dabbing.
And okay.
You're muted besides Pastor Joey and myself.
So before we begin our worship service, we do have some announcements I'd like to make. And so you, if you're part of our regular part of our church community, you should be getting the emails as well. But just as a reminder, all our services and fellowships and activities have moved online. And so our Sunday worship service, as you're joining with us now, is 10 o'clock, 11:15. And it should be the same link. So all our gatherings, it should be the same link. And so even if, for example, you happen to miss an email or you're not sure what the link is, just look at the previous week's links and it should all be the same links. Also, just a reminder, we have our Sunday school classes starting at 11:30 to 12:30. We have a Sunday school class for our college and adults and above. We also have a class for 9th through 12th graders and 6th through 8th graders as well. And we also have our baptism class. So for those of you interested in getting baptized or wanting to learn more about baptism, you can please contact Pastor Helicon. Also, this coming week, it's the first Wednesday of the month, this coming Wednesday, and so we will actually be having our monthly English ministry prayer meeting, and of course, we won't be gathering physically together, but we will be gathering virtually together, and so there's a link for that as well that you can join us this Wednesday from 8 to 9:30, and so that's going to be via Zoom, and we want to encourage you, all of you, to join us this Wednesday night to be able to pray together, especially during this season of life that we're all in. It's so important for us to gather together, to be able to pray for one another and pray for those around us as well. For our other gatherings, our Oasis Fellowship and Salt Shakers gatherings are Friday nights and Saturday nights as well. We invite you to join us for that also. Also, during this time with tithes and offerings, it's hard to physically write a check and drop it off, which you can do, but you can also donate via PayPal as well. So please check your emails for the link for that as well. And also during this season, since we're not able to kind of see each other regularly, Pastor Helicon has a morning Zoominity, I can't even pronounce it, Devo time from 9 to 10 a.m., and that's Monday through Fridays. And then also for Salt Shakers Youth Group, we've got a morning devotional time from 10 to 10:30 as well. And this is just a great way for us to connect with one another throughout the week, to be able to pray together and to grow closer together as well. Also, one other, I actually have two special announcements, one by me and the next one is by our brother Mike Tai. This next one is actually regarding our deacons. And so for those of you that may or may not know, we are actually have new deacons installed. And I believe last Sunday was supposed to be actually our official deacon installation service. But because we're gathering online, we will be postponing kind of our formal installation service to a time when we can gather physically together. But in the meantime, our new deacons are still on board and going to start serving. And so on the slide there, you can see for our Chinese ministry, Brother Frankie Lim, that's Jaden and Jamie's dad, will be serving as the CM worship deacon. Also, Nicole Lim, that is Emma Sue's mom, she's going to be our finance deaconess. And then Randong Lin, who is San San's husband, Timothy Chang's older brother-in-law, Sansan's Timothy Chang's older sister. He's going to be the CM, a welcoming and hospitality deacon. And then from our English ministry side, so excited to have Allison come on board and to be able to serve as our English ministry praise and worship deacon. And so please do keep these brothers and sister in prayer as they start serving as deacon and deaconesses, especially during this season where it's going to look a lot different with a lot of things being online and virtually as well. Okay, and also keep them in prayer and support them too. Okay, at this time I'd like to turn the time to Mike. So Brother Mike Tai has an announcement that he'd like to make.
Thanks Pastor Joey. For everyone, you should have received an email this week about a medical supplies initiative that we are trying as a church, as an entire church, both English and Chinese side, to donate specific items that can help local health clinics. Huge shout out to Stephanie Chang, who was able to present and share this idea with our service team, and is going to be donating or going to be distributing these items to the different health clinics in the email this Wednesday. So if you have not donated yet and you have items that you would like to donate, there's still time. Please contact me and let me know. Huge thanks to Eric and Angela, who have volunteered to be pickup individuals. And so they are willing to drive to your house to pick up these items. Or if it's convenient for you, you can also drop it off at my house. Just make sure you contact me beforehand. So we've already received quite a lot of donations. So this has been really, really nice. And everyone who's donated has really expressed kind of the love and care for those in the health industry during this time. We also have brothers and sisters who are in the health industry from our church. And so do keep all those individuals in prayer. We'll be distributing the items this Wednesday. So if you have not donated and have items, please contact me as soon as possible. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mike, for coordinating, and thank you for everyone that has been helping out. And so please do consider donating. And Mike, you said there's a list, or online there's a link of the different items that people can donate. That is correct, right?
There's a link online, and the most general items are masks and sanitation wipes.
Okay, great. Thank you. And this is just a great way, an important way for us as a church to be able to serve and help those that are on the front lines with COVID-19. So thank you, Mike, and thank you for everyone for helping out with that. Okay. At this time, let me pray for us, and then I'll turn the time over to Allison as he leads us in praise and worship. So will you join with me in prayer? Let's all stand wherever you are. Let's all stand together as we pray and as we prepare our hearts to worship God this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much, God. We thank you for your grace in our lives, God. We thank you for carrying us through this past week as we continue to make the adjustment to working from home, taking classes online, and even just dealing with family members day in and day out. And God, as we gather this morning, Lord, would you prepare our hearts, God? Remind us of why we are together, even now, that we are your people. We are the body of Christ. God, we are those that have been chosen and called by you, forgiven by you through the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, that we can stand before you wherever we are, God, not because of how good we are, not because of the good things we've done this past week, Lord, but because of your grace to us. And so, Father, we ask, Lord, that as we sing, Lord, together, Lord, help us to sing aloud. Help us to sing joyfully and with thanksgiving, Lord, of who you are. God, you are God who is worthy of our praise because of your holiness, your grace, your power, your majesty. And so, Father, prepare us, Lord. Remind us of who you are. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Joey. Call of worship comes from Psalm 95. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hand formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our maker.
I see your face in every sunrise. The colors of the morning are inside your eyes. The world awakens in the light of the day. I look up to the sky and say, you're beautiful.
I see your power
in the moonlit night, where planets are in motion and the galaxies are bright. We are amazed in the light of the stars. It's all proclaiming who you are. You're beautiful. You're beautiful.
I see you there.
I see you there hanging on a tree. You bled and then you died and then you rose again for me. Now you are sitting on your heavenly throne. Soon we will be coming home. You're beautiful. When we arrive at eternity's shore, where death is just a memory and tears are no more. Now we'll enter in as the wedding bells ring. Your bride will come together and we'll sing. You're beautiful.
Today's New City Catechism comes from, the question reads, why was it necessary for Christ, the Redeemer, to die? I'll answer it together. Since death is the punishment for sin, Christ died willingly in our place to deliver us from the power and penalty of sin and bring us back to God. By his subsidiary atoning death, he alone redeems us from hell and gains for us forgiveness of sin, righteousness, and everlasting life. And the passage from Colossians 1:21-22, and it reads, and you who once were alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, now he has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him. Gift of grace.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me.
The night is dark.
The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing. For in my need, His power is displayed. To this I hold, my Savior will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon. And He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but the Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, I hope is only Jesus, for the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King above me, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. Would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory. The King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Take my place, that you will bear my cross. You lay down your life, that I would be set free. Yeah. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. Unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be set free. Yeah. Oh, Jesus, I sing for you have done for me. Whoa, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Thank you. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
God, Jesus, you've done much, Lord. And your death, the way you conquered death, and the way that you ascended into heaven and see at the right hand of the Father. God, would even in this time, Lord, would we be encouraged, Lord? Would we take heart, Lord, for not only the hope that you bring, but the life that you do bring through your Son, Jesus? And God, would we celebrate that? Would we take this time to also remember what is important in this world? In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Allison. Thank you, everyone, for being with us. Thank you for standing. You can be seated now if you'd like. Please take this moment now, first of all, to grab your Bibles. It's nice to have a physical copy. If you're streaming off your phone, then it's probably best now to grab a physical copy so you can read it. It's weird. It's weird talking to you guys via gallery screen on Zoom. But I'm going to do my best, and hopefully it won't feel too disruptive today. But we are actually currently in a series in our journey through the book of Hebrews, in a series called Jesus is Greater Than. Now, what can I tell you to set the mood, set the tone about this journey that we're going through Hebrews? What is this series about? And I want you to see first and foremost that this was a letter that was written to a people that were under a lot of pressure. These were first century Christians, okay, that were of Jewish background, most of them, right? And they were anxious. They were frustrated because discouraged because the culture around them, the world around them, the perspectives, the views, the beliefs were discouraging them in their faith with God. Not always intentionally, just the other views constantly pressured against them. They'll be like, why do you believe in this God? Why do you believe in this? Why do you hold to these certain actions and practices? And this constant challenge, even the persecution started to happen during this time, and they were great on the first century Christians, and they were discouraged. And as they were discouraged, I want you to think, the question that people were asking was, God, where are you? Where are you in these times? God, are you really there? God, do you care? Do you care about us? Because it seems like you don't care. It seems like our lives doesn't matter to you. And last week, Pastor Joey, what he talked about, and what we talked about over the last couple of weeks, is that Jesus is essentially greater than, that he is greater than the angels, he's greater than Moses. And last week, Pastor Joey kind of looked at a sermon on a reminder of a warning of the past, that if we distrust God, if we live practicing or not trusting God, over time, this can add up. It hardens our hearts, and eventually we are led astray. And so it is important for us to hear God's word and to heed it, to obey it, to believe in it. And so this is essentially kind of what Pastor Joey talked about last week. And this week we get to Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. And what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to read it for us, and then I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to jump into the message, all right? Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. And I didn't put it on the PowerPoint because I want you to hold the Word of God like I am and read from it, because you'll see a lot more details when you see all of it in front of you. So Hebrews chapter 4 says these words. Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as to them. But the message they heard did not benefit them, because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed enter that rest, as he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. And although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again, in this passage, he said, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore, it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly received the good news fail to enter because of disobedience. Again, he appoints a certain day, today, saying through David so long afterward, in the words already quoted, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. Let us, therefore, strive to enter that rest, so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. This is the word of the Lord. Father God, we come this morning to your word, to Hebrews chapter 4, to such a magnificent passage, a passage that at first glance seems kind of weird. It doesn't, why quoting all this Old Testament? Why talk about rest and all these things? And yet, Lord, this text has so much relevance to our lives today, our need today. And oh God, I pray as we are separated physically, we are not separated spiritually with you. We are to you brought together by your Spirit. And this is a chance for us to grow as we are part closer to you. And I pray that you would guide us to your word, prepare our hearts. However comfortable we may feel right now, I pray that today your word, your living word that is sharper than any two-edged sword, that is active, would pierce to our hearts and challenge us today of our convictions, cut to the core of who we are and reconcile us to you, Lord. Oh, Lord, please open our hearts, open our minds, open our ears to your word. And I pray that, Father, I would rely on you today, not just looking at a screen, not looking at Zoom, but trusting that you will do amazing things before this, Lord. And so, Lord, may you be glorified. May you be magnified. May your gospel be proclaimed. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. That was Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 through 13. And the question, again, I want to make us think about is this question, where is God? Where is God? And as I was reading this text today, I was thinking about that. How does this text talk about where is God? How is it relevant to you and me in our lives? And as the more I was reading, the more I was studying this, I was thinking about these last 2 weeks, how we all have been sheltered in place. And I was like, what are the things that are oppressing us and pressuring us today? Now, as I was reflecting on it, I was on Facebook way too much. All I could hear, all I could see constantly was the news about COVID-19 and how people were encouraging online, like, you know, pastors and others, how we are to adjust to this new norm of being at home. And as I was talking to brothers and sisters, it's crazy because I was talking to my friends that have kids and I was spending time with them and they would say to me online, they were like, you know, it's crazy because parents are now, in a sense, teachers, they're caretakers, but they're also employees. And for some of us, we're single or not married, and it's kind of lonely, right? And we're stuck at home. We're tired just from all the work because work actually seems harder. And maybe you're not even sure how you're going to make it through this entire time, right? Because we've been stuck in this, we're kind of like in prison at home, right? So home looks really nice, but when you're there 24/7, it doesn't feel as nice, right? Maybe for some of us it is nice, but for me, it can feel a little bit oppressive, a little bit crushing. And I think especially families with their kids at home, it's exhausting, right? You're cleaning, you're caring for them. You're also having to do your work, come back to this, and you got to also maintain, you know, cooking and preparing and getting groceries. In my reading today, I kept thinking about this. And as you read Hebrews chapter 4, what's interesting is a word keeps coming up. Actually, the word rest, R-E-S-T, comes up multiple times. 8 times, to be exact. And what our text explores today is what we are looking for, what it seems, even ironically, as we are sheltered in place, we haven't found, which is rest. And so that's what we're going to look at today. Okay, how this text today connects to you and me is going to be about the idea of rest. And so my points today are this. And the sermon title says it was the promise of rest, because if you read in the first verse, there's a promise of entering his rest that still stands. And I want you to see how that works. So the 3 points today is the need for rest, that you and I have a need for rest. And then the second point is, what does Hebrews here say? What does the Bible speak about rest? And lastly, that there is a journey that we must take to get to this promised rest, that all of us must take a journey into the promised rest. Okay, these are my 3 points today. And so that takes me to my first point, the need for rest, the need for rest. And if you look at the passage today in Hebrews chapter 4, what you notice is there's a verse that's quoted twice. If you have your little notes on your Bible, the footnotes, it usually tells you this. But 3 times in this text, the author of Hebrews quotes Psalm 95. Why Psalm 95? And Psalm 95 was written by the psalmist, okay, someone who wrote about it, reflecting on a past circumstance, a past situation. And Pastor Joey actually kind of talked about it last week, okay? And this is the story of how Israel had been delivered by God from Egypt. And as they were taken out of Egypt, okay, they were given an opportunity to go and claim the promised land of Canaan. But what happened through the story, and what Psalm 95 is reflecting on, is what happened to the people. Because the people, they distrusted God. They were ungrateful. And if you look into like Numbers 13 to 14, for example, you'll see they grumbled. They're upset. They weren't happy. And what God tells them essentially is this, that if you don't trust me, after all that I've done, your entire generation, if it doesn't trust me, they don't trust me, even after I've saved you, you will have to journey until you die. You will have to journey until you die because you do not get to go into the promised land because you cannot appreciate, you're not grateful. And the only 2 people actually that make it into the promised land is Joshua and Caleb, because they actually go scout the land and they're the ones that come back and say, hey, we should go and claim it. God got our back. But nobody listens to them. And so what happens is God's punishment for this generation for their unbelief is that they end up having to journey endlessly through the wilderness until they all die. And the thing I thought about as I was reflecting, why Psalm 95, okay, is that the most difficult thing you and I face today that we don't even realize, and what often exhausts you and me every day as we go about our lives, is that we are often on a journey and we never get to our destination. Okay, what I'm saying here is that we are tired from work. Now, I'm going to talk about work today a little bit, okay? But the idea of no rest, and we are overworked. And this is what happens to the people of Israel for their disobedience. They keep journeying, they keep walking, and they're overworked. They're tired. And I think rest is something that you and I so much need today. But what do I hear from my friends? From all my friends, from my community, from college students, from everybody, is that I'm burnt out. I'm exhausted. People are being burned out from their jobs. They're burned out from their ministry work. They're burned out from their hobbies, the things that they've even enjoyed. And why is that? And I would say it's because overwork has killed us. And what overwork looks like is this. It takes the joy. It takes the excitement. It takes the hope of the things that we do. It makes things that we used to love become monotonous. And that ends up for us losing some idea of the passion, the fun of doing those things. It can also destroy our families. It destroys our relationships. It destroys even our children, right? It destroys relationships, which is crazy to me. And what I want you to do today is you think about work, okay, and take a think about rest. Is as I was thinking about the Hebrew Bible and I was reflecting on this, it's interesting because if you read in Exodus, we read this together as a church about a year ago, 2 years ago almost now. And in Exodus, what do we cover? We explored the Ten Commandments. And it's interesting, I was thinking about it, is why, remember, what is the fourth commandment? What is the fourth commandment? And of course, I hear the answers right there in front of you. It's keeping the Sabbath day. And it's, it, to me, I was wondering is why is the idea of keeping the Sabbath included on the list with you shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not covet. Why is keeping the Sabbath just as important as not doing all these negative things? And I think the reason is God knows that our work can also be a way where people can be destroyed. That our work is a way that we can devalue ourselves or others and to be diminished. We can be less, just like killing, just like stealing, just like coveting. And this is something that makes sense for you and me, because I think as we live in Silicon Valley, and especially in COVID-19, this is really true. And so I asked the question to myself, why are we so overworked? Why are people so burnt out? As I've been working, as I've been sheltered in place, I get more tired easily now. I think part of it is because I'm not moving around as much. Maybe it's the lack of contact, but I think it's because I have more meetings now, because now I don't have to travel as much. I spend more time meeting with people. So I do more, even though I'm supposed to, since be doing less. And I think we do this. We are all like this. We are burning out. We are overworked. I'm not saying all of us, but we end up becoming overworked. And I'll give you a few reasons why I think this happens, okay? The first reason that we get overworked is because we are overconnected, okay? Wrong direction, wrong. Yeah, our connectivity. I was thinking about this and I was like, we're so connected because of our smartphones, because of our Zoom, because of Google Hangouts, because of the tablets we have, that we are always, as far apart as we are right now, we are actually kind of closer and more accessible. And you can't seem to get away, because you could be sitting on your toilet and someone calls you for a meeting. You could have a meeting with them even on the toilet if you wanted to, right? And I was thinking about this because I was talking to Paul and I was talking to Brother Tim in our church. And Paul, what he said to me that was very insightful was actually now he has more meetings, or he's busy with work, but he still has to do care, childcare, help take care of cooking, or you know, making sure to clean the house and take care of the kids on top of working at his job. And then Tim was telling me in a conversation a week ago, that he has actually more meetings because now people are making sure each other is okay. And so now they're always online trying to make sure everything's doing okay. And otherwise, you know, they could have said things just to each other in the office. And so our connectivity is often one of the primary reasons we are overworked, because it's so easy to be called into another meeting, right? Booked into another meeting. So that's my first point, that we are why one of the reasons is our connectivity. Our second reason is tied to our culture, okay? And I think today, one of the other reasons is that our culture extols the importance and the essential nature of our work. That if you work, that is how you ascribe your worth, your value. That your work defines you. Let me ask you this question. When you meet people for the first time, what is one of the first few questions you ask them about themselves? What do you ask them? What do you do? Where do you work? Where do you go to school? This is because work is such a big part of our lives. And I was actually thinking about this. How does work become such a big part of our lives? And there was this New York Times piece that was written in 2014, a short little piece, but it was interesting. It was this author, this professor from Rutgers. His name is Okulix Kozarin. He says this in a New York Times article. And I have the link if you ever need to find it. He wrote in this section, he says, Protestant influence and a strong belief in individualism, which is taking things in one's own hands, making it without help, proving yourself, account for some of the aspects of the strong American work ethic. But Americans are also forced to work more than others. In many other developed countries, there's universal health care, there's education that's cheaper or free, and in the US, you need to have money to access these things. Inequality is also more marked, so it makes more sense that you have to work harder to be a winner. And what this professor is saying is something very interesting, that oftentimes our mindset of why we do work is tied to you and I, to our individualism of our culture. Our culture today promotes individuality. It promotes that you are called to achieve, that you are self-made, that you need to be self-earned. But this wasn't actually the way we used to always do things, if you think about it. And if you're from an Asian culture, you probably understand what I'm saying, is that traditionally, even in the Eastern Asian context, it wasn't just about your success, that your success also was tied to your family, about your name. That you are not just promoting yourself, but you're also helping your family reach a level of viability. That's why our families would open certain businesses to get you ahead, so your family could get to another level of economic viability. And as a result, our work before was for others, for our family. But today, more and more so, because of our culture, our work is about the individual, not the family. And so as that has kind of creeped into our mindset, we start to think, how did I get here? It must be because I did these things. I have to accomplish this task. I have to, in order for me to reach a certain social status or level, I must do certain things to get there. And we are all pursuing after this. And that's why I would give a suggestion is you're tired. You're exhausted because you're always trying to grasp after that. You want me to show you how that works? How it works in our lives today, especially in Cupertino, maybe in Saratoga, San Jose. I'll give you guys an example. And you guys will laugh because you'll know this is true, okay? But I'm gonna use it through my girlfriend, Joyce. Joyce is a teacher. She's a Christian school teacher. And in this private school, it's a well-to-do school. People, parents pay, are successful. They pay a lot of money. They pay big bucks for their children's success. They expect that their kids, by being paid well, will get an education that will give them a head start. And so the parents push the kids. They're hard on the teacher. They're hard on the parents, their children, okay? And I think that that is very similar in a way that we express our overwork. Our children become the means to individual success. How? I was driving a few weeks ago when I was coming to church or driving somewhere, and it's interesting. But I'm driving by and I see all these prep schools. Like just on Stevens Creek, you see a bunch of A-plus tutoring, A-plus SAT prep. Oh, over Saratoga, over Cupertino, Santa Clara, there's all these like Harvard School of, or Ivy League prep, right? It's just to convince parents that you need to take this program to maximize your child's potential to get ahead. And I think we do these things because, like our society, we believe a person's worth is based around their achievement. What awards will your kids get? What awards do I have? What scholarships have I achieved or received from the schools I got into? Actually, what prestigious school did you go to? Or are you planning to go to? What were you accepted? How did you test in your scores? And I see that all over here, just here in Silicon Valley, but it's all over the world, but especially in the US, right? And now what I would say is this, our overwork has over affected our parenting, our kids. Not me, I'm not a parent yet, but I see it. What are we doing? What are you doing when you're doing overwork and it's tied to your kids? I'll show you. We're using our children to find a measure of our own worth. This is really scary, but we do this. That we tie our success to our child's success in school. That we are a good parent based around how well our kids achieve. And what happens, I've seen this, I've heard this from our kids, from my peers, from college students for years, is our kids are depressed. Our community, our children, we are depressed. We're anxious. We're exhausted. We're discouraged because we never feel like we're good enough. I heard this so much in college. Do you know how real this is? How many of you have felt this? And this leads to my last thing, which is not on the PowerPoint slide, so you don't have to move forward wrong, is it ties to our conscience, our connectivity, our culture, our hearts. That if you talk to your peers, you talk to your community, this idea keeps driving our hearts, our conscience. It happens at every age, every level. It happens to all you guys as well as me at our age group in Silicon Valley. You know, our parents say, oh, I would never do what my parents did to me, pushing me so hard, right? But somehow every day when you wake up, your life never seems to be good enough. Maybe it wasn't your parents that said it. Maybe it was your classmates or your coworkers that make you feel that way. You don't feel good enough. You don't feel, you're always wondering, did I do enough? Could I have done more to be better? What I'm trying to say today, guys, in your conscience, you know this too, is that we're restless and we're just as lost in the wilderness as this generation that is being talked about in Hebrews chapter 4. You see, we're tired, we're exhausted, and we need rest, and we haven't found it. That's my first point. And so the question then after this is, what does the Bible say about rest? What does the Bible say about rest? I'm sorry, I'm running a little late, but it's okay. And what the author of Hebrews says is that the audience is tired, and they're tired, and we're tired, and we need a rest. And how do we get it? And what he does is he paints how we can get rest by using different imagery of rest throughout the Bible. Use different reference points of what rest looks like. So the first rest that he talks about is the rest, which is a promise of freedom. And if you look in the verses, in the very first verse, 3a of verse 3, he quotes Psalm 95. He says, we who have believed enter that rest, as I swore in my wrath that they shall not enter my rest. And what he's talking about is he's quoting from Psalm 95, which Pastor Joey talked about, which I've said about, which is the warning to the people that if you continue to disregard God's word, what he has said through Moses, and you keep choosing your own ways, you're never going to find the promised rest of Canaan. And so you have to remember the story of Egypt, right? The people of Israel, they were in Egypt. They were slaves. They were utterly enslaved. They were hopeless. They were crushed under pressure of society, the world, their leadership, and they were overworked. They were being overworked. You just look at Exodus 1, read Exodus chapter 1, read Exodus chapter 2, read Exodus chapter 5. And they're crying out to God, and God hears them. And through his servant Moses, and through amazing actions, he saves his people. He brings them out of slavery into freedom. And he brings them out of across an ocean, right? Bring across a sea and gets them to freedom so that they no longer have to do anything under the oppressiveness of the Egyptians. They had experienced a true freedom. That was what was given to them. That was promised to them. What I would say is this. When you can let go of your work today, when you can let go of the work you're doing right now, and you can fully rest to let go of your effort, this is the things that you're actually saying. Okay, I'm going to give you a few things that you're really saying. First of all, what you're saying is, I'm not just a piece of a machine or part of a machine of my company or my industry. I'm not just a piece that has to be there. I'm not an absolute essential piece. Okay. Second thing you're saying is this: I'm not enslaved to my society's expectations of my worth and value, but based around what I do or cannot do. Okay. That you're not enslaved to that because you're free from that. You've been taken out of that. And lastly, what it's saying is this: I am not enslaved or defined by my work. It does not equate my identity. My work is not everything. Okay. And what you're saying instead of these three things, you're saying is, my identity, when you can truly be free, is my identity is in God, because I'm not just a slave. I'm not a slave to the world, but I am ultimately his child. And what God had done by freeing his people of Egypt from their systems of control in their lives was God was promising them a better freedom. I'm giving you a freedom for you forever. That's what he was showing them in their escape. In their escape that was caused and manifested and led by God through Moses. God did the work. And this leads to my second idea of promise, okay? Rest is a promise of fulfillment. That's my second. And what does that mean? If you read verses 3-5, the rest of verse 3-5, so 3b, it says at the end of that quote, it says, although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again, in the passage, he said, they shall not enter my rest. He again quotes Psalm 95, but he here is referencing something more ancient. He says the rest that you're looking for God actually has already been in it. He has given us this rest. What do I mean? How did he give it? And what it alludes to is Genesis, the very beginning of the Bible, where God talks about creation and how God in Genesis 2, verse 2 to 3 says these words. He says, on the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done. He rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day, made it holy, because on it, God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. And what this is saying is that God, after seeing that all his work had been done in creation, it was good and he was finished. There was nothing to add anymore. God was satisfied with what he had done. And so here is what rest is. Okay, the promise of fulfillment is another promise that God gives about rest. Is that rest is the ability to really let things go. That's my next point. And to not have to do any more because things are complete or finished. It's the ability to let something go and not to have to do any more things because everything has been accomplished or finished. How many of you here have sought to rest? And because you haven't really let go of your work, maybe your work wasn't done, maybe it was a project that wasn't complete, a homework assignment that wasn't done, you're still restless. Let me give you an example. How many of you have a work project that's in the it's down the line, there's a deadline down the line, but you can't finish it today. You just need months to work at it, right? Or a person with a paper that needs to be finished or a final that needs to be taken. Though you're still essentially not doing it yet, it's always in the back of your head. What happens? When you're on vacation, you're on a weekend trip, you're having fun, you're resting, but in the back of your head, that thing is still there irking you. And you're always kind of going, oh man, every time there's some time to think about it, you come back to that idea, right? That's not rest, my friends. That's not real rest. You're not really rested because you're not fully satisfied and there's still things to be done. And it's just in the reality of your life, it's so hard to let things go. It's so hard to disconnect truly from everything. And I was in seminary and I was learning through about Sabbath. And what one of my professors said is that Sabbath, or I was reading, I forgot where, that honoring Sabbath is really to learn to honor above all things that you are more than your work. You are more than your work. Why? Because you and I are made in God's image. And because we're made in God's image, when we disconnect from the world, when we disconnect from the things that are attaching to us to force us to depend on them or to be stressed out, we're discovering who we really are. That we ultimately are not about our work or about attainment, but that we come and we realize that God is the one that we truly rely on. We are more than a work. We were meant to be reliant fully on God. And that's what the Sabbath is. It's a rest in relevance to the world and irrelevance to see God as completely relevant. So why do we feel so dissatisfied? Why do you feel unhappy with your current circumstances? I've talked to you. Some of you are not happy with your lives. You're not happy the way you look. You're not happy with the way your life has turned out. Maybe your status of your life. And there's always something that you can't seem to accomplish. There's an itch that you cannot scratch. You never feel like you're enough. That you have all more to prove. That you have to do more things for your family, maybe for yourself, maybe for the world. What is that dissatisfaction? What is the thing that never seems to go away in your life? Unless you find a measure of ability to let it go, you're going to always be a slave to this world. You will always be a slave if you can never truly let it go because you're still not free. You haven't really let it go. And this leads me to my last statement in the second point, that rest, ultimately, there's a promise. You can have this too. You can have this rest. If you read verse 8, it says, "For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on." If you know the story, who actually ends up going to the promised land isn't Moses. Moses doesn't get there, right? Joshua has to take them in because Moses was disobedient and he was only able to see it, but he could not enter it. And Joshua gets them there. But here it says, Joshua's rest, even though that they had accomplished reaching some sort of rest, it wasn't the ultimate rest that God talks about. That there is a real Sabbath that we can get. And if you read Psalm 95, it's really interesting because the psalmist is reminding them that there's more to this rest. This rest is after Joshua. It's actually for the present day reader too. It's a rest for your soul. It's a rest that is ultimate, that is promised by God, that is given to us and available. We can experience it. That's my second point. And this leads to my third point, that there is a journey you need to take into the promised land. How can we get this rest? In verse 11, it's interesting because he says, let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. This is not a passive waiting for it to happen. This is an active pursuit of this rest that you need. And it's weird because right after he says this, read verse 12 to 13. It's crazy. It says, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature, right, is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. And what it's saying here, guys, brothers and sisters, is that the word of God is like the sharpest sword that cuts to who you really are. That the word of God cuts to you, the deepest person you are, the real you that you don't want the world to see, the real you that you have blocked from everybody because you're ashamed of it. You put walls up, you put facades, you put barriers, you put curtains. It cuts to the real you, and it knows and it discerns who that person is. And I want you to understand, this is such a scary statement. Because what he's saying here, he's saying is God cuts to the real heart of your motivations, your intentions. That you are so vulnerable before God. You are stripped. You are exposed. You are naked. You are helpless before him. God sees the real you that you don't want anybody else to see. It's the you that the world, you couldn't think anybody in the world could love you for. Why does this have to happen? Why does this have to be exposed? And I was thinking about this, and I was reading Genesis 2, and it hit me. What happened to man and woman originally in the Garden of Eden? You see, Adam and Eve in Genesis 2, they were naked. They were unashamed. It actually says this in Genesis 2, verse 25. It says, the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. It wasn't an issue. They were comfortable in their skin. They were satisfied. They had nothing to prove. They were fulfilled. They had all that they needed. They had nothing to show for, to worry about. But the moment in the story where they turn from God, they chose a different way, what happens? And if you read the story, it's really sad because God intended for us, people, man and women, to rule over the world as kings and queens. We were to be stewards of his creation. But it wasn't enough for us because we couldn't bear to see someone else above us. We wanted to be where God was. So we couldn't bear with knowing that God was a bit bigger than us. So we decided we have to be our own saviors. So we disobeyed him. And the reality is this. For you to turn away from the ways of pursuing work endlessly and tirelessly is to realize that you need to turn away from yourself, okay? That you cannot do anything without God's grace. Because here in the story, what happens is the moment they eat of the fruit that they were not supposed to eat, they became ashamed. They felt exposed. They didn't feel like they were enough. They felt naked. And they started to think, who are we? We must not be good enough. And you know what was crazy? They thought maybe God wouldn't love them the way they are, that they weren't enough for God. And that is the underlying problem in all our hearts. We never feel like we're enough. Think about your life. What are the reasons that you get so embarrassed or defensive? How can we get so easily exposed or ashamed or feeling so insufficient? Why don't you think you're good enough for another person to love you or to date you, to marry you? Why do you think that you're a nobody because your job title is a certain thing? Or that your school that you go to rather than that school defines who you are? Or that you need to achieve a certain level of success to be something? Why do you think you're less because you're not as gifted when you compare yourself to someone in your group or your friends? Why do you feel you're less? Why do you have to feel like you have to compare yourself by your grades or your skills or your performance?
you're hiding from others. You're hiding from God because you're ashamed. And unless you understand that you're always looking for this great ultimate peace, you're never going to find it. You'll never find the rest that God promises because you're still trying to find it on your own. You haven't turned from your ways. You think you could do it yourself. And let me give you a point. Let me give you a thought to think. Read verse 10. It says, verse 9 and 10 says, then there remains the Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. There's this ultimate rest that is promised. And the reality is work bad? So let me take a moment to digress to think about this. Helicon, you've saying that I need rest, I need this, but what's wrong with actually wanting to do a good job? What's wrong with trying to pursue a task or work, a good job in my life? Is it bad? And what I want to tell you is this, working hard, making a life better for your family, those are not bad things. I'm not against the work itself. The work itself is not what's bad, okay? Here's the key, it's your motivations. It's your motivations. It's the reasons that you work that are wrong. Okay, that is what's wrong. You and I scrape, work so hard, some reason, to comfort ourselves, to believe, and to reassure ourselves that we are okay, that we are enough the way we are. And if you believe that your work will somehow make you okay before God, if you actually think that everything you do will actually earn you way to God, you will never reach the promised land. You will never feel satisfied. You will never feel complete because you still believe it's all on your own engine, on your own effort. You will never be at peace because deep down, you work for the most selfish reasons. It's because you do it for yourself. You're not doing it really for God. You're doing it so you can feel good, to be wanted, to feel appreciated. And I'm going to confess something that I think it scares you to hear this from your pastor, but I'm sure Pastor Joey and I have talked about it. One of the greatest anxieties I think pastors have, and we've talked about this, so Pastor Joey knows, is that we can often make our holy work of preaching and teaching and caring is actually just as dangerous as anybody's work. Because if my work becomes what defines my worth and not Jesus Christ, then I'm doing it for all the wrong reasons. If I'm thinking that my message is good because I did it well and it sounds good and people responded, that's what makes me feel whole. It's not Jesus that's making me feel whole, right? It's my selfishness, my labor, my actions. So even the best things in your life can become things that cause dissonance with God because you define your faith based on your work. And pastors struggle with that just as much as anybody else. And I would say that the greatest obstacle you and I face to true rest today is not just the evil things, because not all of you here are drug dealers. Not all of you here are like murderers, right? Right. It's not the bad sins that we all hear about. It's the good things that we talk about too much. It's the good things in your life that actually are just as bad as the evil things. Your good that you do is just as easy of a way where you believe that it's about yourself. That you are complete and good enough because you did the right things. If you live with that mindset, it's self-righteousness. It's works still. And if you read the scriptures, you read the Christians of old, you read the people, they're always fighting this desire. They're fighting that even their good actions could be done for the wrong reasons because it still makes in their head think that they did everything themselves. And if you read Philippians 3, and I won't read it too fast, but Philippians 3, Paul says these words. He says, and I'll summarize it for you today. He says, if you think it's all these reasons, right? I'm the most holy of the people, right? I've done all these things. I've lived all these things out the right way. But in the middle of the end, it says, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, whatever gain I had, I counted as a loss. Indeed, I count everything as a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus Christ as our Lord, for my Lord. And the next, for his sake, I've suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. They're worth nothing in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness that comes from my own effort, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible, I may attain the resurrection from the dead. What Paul says here, which is crazy, is that none of his works defines him, even though he's one of the most craziest, awesomest authors, right, in the book, the Bible, right? Because nothing matters compared to knowing Jesus. Jesus is the answer. Jesus is greater than himself. That's what Paul's saying. And he clings to that truth. And if you read verse 8, it's interesting because it says, what does it say in verse 8? It says, if Joshua had given them rest, okay? Joshua had given them rest. And if you think about it, who is Joshua? In the Old Testament, if he couldn't get them rest, what Jesus is the ultimate Joshua. Even Joshua in Greek, I think, is Jesus. His name is Jesus. And Jesus, the ultimate Joshua, was whom God was talking about another day that comes. And you have to ask yourself, how does Jesus become the ultimate Joshua that brings us to full rest? And it's in Matthew 11. This is a verse that we use for Oasis. It says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. And what he says is this. His assumption is, you are working already. You're working so hard. You're so tired. But Jesus says, I give you a rest. Take my yoke. Don't use the yoke of the world. Take my yoke. Make me the way you need to prove yourself. You want to prove yourself before God by your own effort. That won't work. Take my yoke. Let me be the way you prove to God that you're good enough. Because that's the only way you're going to find rest. And how does Jesus do this? This is the most important thing I'm going to say today. It's because of the cross. I'm talking to a screen. It's so hard to talk to you guys. It's the cross because Jesus lays stretched out. He's naked. He's vulnerable on the cross. He's utterly helpless. He's utterly vulnerable, utterly viciously being mocked by the people that few days before were worshiping him, welcoming him. And his friends betrayed him. And yet he goes there to die for you and me. Why? And at the end of his life, at the very end of his life, he says these words in John chapter 19, verse 30. He says, it is finished. And if you look at the word, what it means is, I have accomplished. I have done the work. It derives from an idea of finishing a task. What task did he finish? He did the ultimate work that had to be done, that had to be satisfied, that had to be complete in your life and my life. And what Jesus says here is, I have done the work that needs to be done before God. I have borne the sin of man. And I've died for them. That is the yoke you carry. When God sees you, he sees his son Christ. He sees the sins that have been removed from your life. You are a pure person before God because of what Jesus has done. And that's why in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 9 to 10, it says, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God, for whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. And what Jesus says is, I have lived as you should have lived your life, attached to God, but you didn't do that. But I lived that life for you. And so then I go to the cross, vulnerable, naked, crushed, and I've died the death that you deserve to die because you're never going to be good enough. But you can rest in the truth in me and be satisfied with your life. In me is the real Sabbath. In me is the real rest. Your peace, your rest ultimately for your soul. Do you guys understand what I'm saying today? I'm out of breath talking about it, but what I'm saying is, all the pursuit you go after, the work you do, every day you don't feel good enough, it's because you're trying to save yourself and you haven't turned to God. You haven't repented and turned to him. And God says, take my yoke. I've done the dying for you. I have done the living that you needed to do. You don't have to write the story you want to write anymore. I will write the greatest story, and you are in it if you believe, if you commit to this, you stop trying to prove to God you're good enough. I am good enough. Accept that. And what it says in verse 11 is, we must strive. Why? Why must we keep going after it if we have it? And the truth is this, you are in this world. And as long as you're in this world, you're alive, you're breathing, you have human bodies, you have human desires, you have human wants. You will fight this battle as Paul does, as Pastor Helicon does, as Pastor Joey does. You have to stop trying to prove and use the good things to prove yourself. Not just the bad things, but the good things too. You need to come to the cross every day. See that Jesus has laid his life down on the cross. He's been vulnerable for you and naked, so you don't have to prove anymore. Every moment you stray, every time you fail, you can come to the cross. And your work starts to become, whenever your work starts to define you, come back to God. Come back to his word. And the living word, the word of God, is like a living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword. It pierces to the division of souls. It searches your hearts, cuts to your soul and your spirit. It searches and assesses the true intentions and thoughts of your mind. Nothing is hidden from God. This is why you need the gospel every day. This is why you need the word of God every day. This is why we ask you to read the Bible, why we challenge you to read the Bible, why we ask you to gather as a body of Christ, so that every day you have accountability to this, that you realize you need Jesus, that Jesus is greater than. Are you tired? Are you restless? Are you exhausted? You need this rest. Do you realize Jesus has brought you in? Jesus, Joshua, the ultimate Joshua, has brought you to the promised land. You just have to believe. Let us pray. Father God, sorry for being so late on time, but Lord, thank you for your text, so rich. Oh Lord, that we would accept you. Lord, we believe in you. Will we rest in your true rest? We give this to you, Lord, right now. We commit this to you. We commit each person to you. We ask for your blessing and your grace today as we go before you. And may we honor you in all things. In Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
If you all please rise or just set your hearts, go ahead and close the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Please continue to stay standing as we close in prayer and then with the benediction or Lord's blessing. Heavenly Father God, we thank you so much, God, for this morning where we can gather to worship you, not only through the singing and hearing of songs, Lord, but the reading and hearing and preaching of your word as well. And Father, we pray, Lord, that as we conclude this time together, may your word, which we've heard, continue to dwell in our heart. God, may your truth and the life of your word, God, continue to work in our hearts, God, transforming us, Lord, reminding us, Lord, of the rest that we find and that we can find and that we can have only through Christ Jesus. And so, Lord, we ask that as we conclude this time, Lord, may your spirit of peace and of rest be upon our hearts, Lord, as we go about this day. Lord, thank you for your grace. Thank you that Christ has accomplished everything for us on the cross, Lord. And all we need to do is to rest and have confidence and faith in that. For this day and for this coming week, we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God our Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen and amen. Thank you so much for joining us online this morning. And for those of you that are able to, we want to encourage you to join us for our Sunday school classes, which will be starting in about 8 minutes, 10 minutes or so. So if you want, go ahead and take a break, use the restroom, get some water, and hopefully love to see you in one of our Sunday school classes. Also, don't forget, as Mike Kai mentioned, about the drive that we're having for those in healthcare, so whether it's masks or hand sanitizers, other things as well, please do contact Mike Tai. His email is tai mike tai@gmail.com if you want to contact him about that as well. So thank you so much and have a blessed day.
Thank you. Have a beautiful day. Sorry I went long.